All right. Good afternoon, everyone. I call this meeting of the House Transportation Committee to order. This meeting is being live streamed as a reminder. Blade, will you please take the roll?
Acting Chair Mullins.
Present.
Representative Nielsen.
Here.
Bellman.
Here.
Curry.
Here.
Hohenstein.
Here.
McAndrew.
Here.
McNeil.
Here.
O'Mara.
Here.
Pashinsky.
Designation.
Here.
Sorry, the microphone keeps turning off. Siegel.
Designation.
Warren.
Here.
Designation.
Chairman Benninghoff. Cabell.
Here.
He's online.
Devonzo.
Designation.
Labs.
Here.
Major.
Designation.
Ortitai.
Designation.
Schurin.
Here.
Schmidt.
Designation.
Smith.
Designation.
Struzzi. I'm sorry, Stamball.
Here. Here.
And Struzzi.
Here.
Quorum is present.
Thank you so much, Blade. Quorum being established, we can proceed with the agenda. The first item on our agenda is House Bill 1662, introduced by our Chairman, Representative Ed Nielsen. I move to consider House Bill 1662. Is there a second? Representative Hohenstein. Seconds the bill. Kyle, will you please give a summary of the bill?
House Bill 1662 by Representative Ed Nielsen. This bill provides for the automated work zone speed enforcement program, also known as active work zone speed cameras, and makes other technical changes as follows. First, it eliminates the February 16th, 2024 statutory expiration date and makes the program permanent. It requires that at least one of the two warning signs has flashing lights that are enabled at all times when the system is active. It requires that at least one of the two warning signs be placed at least 1,000 feet before the active work zone unless PennDOT or the Turnpike Commission determines a lesser distance is needed to ensure safety or comply with federal regulations. It clarifies that the lessee of a leased vehicle is considered the owner of vehicle under the program. It removes outdated language relating to fine allocation and clarifies that fine revenue shall continue to be used to develop a work zone and highway safety program, increase awareness of distracted driving, and be used for transportation enhancement grants. This is currently where the fine revenue goes in it for the last 2 years. It allows for hearings to contest violations to be conducted virtually. Hearings shall only be at the locations and times set by the system administrator. And finally, it adds a defense that the person named in the violation was not operating the vehicle at the time of the violation. The owner may be required to submit evidence that the owner was not the driver at the time of the violation. The system administrator may not require the owner to disclose the identity of the actual operator of the vehicle. This defense is identical to current defenses authorized for the red light camera program, the Roosevelt Boulevard speed camera program in Philadelphia, and the school bus stop arm camera program.
Thank you so much, Kyle. So this piece of legislation is critically important, as you can hear just from the ground it covers. The program, the work zone speed camera program, has been in place for the last 5 years. And in 2022, there were over 444,000 violations issued. Of these violations, over 81% were first offenses, and only 18.6% were second or subsequent offenses. These numbers clearly show that most drivers are slowing down in these zones and after getting their first offense, which is only a written warning. We have also seen a 15 to 50% reduction in the number of crashes in work zones when the speed cameras are present versus when they are not present. My brother-in-law, and I'm sure many of your family members work somewhere in proximity to construction, road construction. So this is, of course, personally important to me, and I'm sure to you. Without this legislation, this program would expire on February 16th, 2024, which in reality is right around the corner with how time moves. We can't let that expiration happen. This program has been successful at reducing excessive speeding and protecting our motorists and roadside workers. The goal of this program is not to raise revenue. That's a very important point. It's to increase safety. 90 PennDOT employees have lost their lives in the line of duty since 1970, and I would ask that you support this bill and help better protect our roadside workers and the motoring public. Thank you very much. Now, are there any comments or anyone seeking recognition on House Bill 1662? Chairman Benninghoff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just briefly, I wanted to say I think these additional attributes within the bill are important. I want to thank the chairman for including some of the suggestions our party had made in references to the warning signs and warning flashing lights. I think that's good for everybody regardless, and I think it makes the bill overall better. And thank you for including those in there.
Chair, thanks to gentlemen. Representative O'Mara.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to also add support for the bill and for the changes that we are making to this program. I actually hold a series of town halls every summer, and this exact topic came up during two of them because people were frustrated by tickets that they got. And I'm happy to defend the program because we do need to increase safety, but I think these consumer protections make sense, especially if the driver wasn't operating the vehicle. That's included in other pieces of legislation that we already have passed and have passed into law, and I'm happy that we are moving that component of the bill forward as well. Thank you.
The chair thanks the representative. Any other members seeking recognition? No one else? Nope. Representative McAndrew.
I just want to state, first and foremost, that worker safety is a key component in this state and in this in with us in the majority. And I think that this really takes a step forward to make sure that people are protected. And, you know, whether it's this or OSHA reform or other things, this is a top priority for us in the House of Representatives to make sure that workers and their safety and their families are thought of first and foremost. Thank you.
Chair, thanks to the representative for his comments. Any further comments? Sorry. Are there any negative votes on House Bill 1662? No negative votes. House Bill 1662 is unanimously reported as committed. Thank you very much. The final item on our agenda is House Resolution 197, introduced by Representative Pat Gallagher. And I move to consider House Resolution 197. Is there a second? Representative Bellman seconds. Kyle, would you please give a summary of the bill?
House Resolution 197 by Representative Pat Gallagher. This is a concurrent resolution extending the governor's disaster emergency issued on June 12, 2023, and previously extended until November 1st, 2023, in response to the collapse of a portion of Interstate 95 in the city of Philadelphia by an additional 120 calendar days. This disaster declaration was previously extended by Senate Resolution 136 to November 1st, 2023. This resolution would extend it beyond November 1st by an additional 120 calendar days.
Thank you very much, Kyle. I ask the members to support the resolution, of course, that as you probably know and followed, the temporary bridge replacement was open after just 12 days. And while those 12 days, I'm sure, felt like much longer for commuters in and around I-95, that was still an extraordinary effort, but the work is still underway on the permanent bridge replacement. So this extension will ensure that the work can continue without interruption. And with that, I would ask if there are any comments or questions on the bill. Representative Hohenstein.
Thank you, Chair. As a representative from Northeast Philly, where all of this occurs, I'm going to say thank you to my colleague, Representative Gallagher, and thank you to Chairman Nielsen, who's also a Northeast Philadelphia rep as well, and I'm sure Representative Bellman would join me in those things. Northeast Philly and all of Philly actually is impacted by this I-95 corridor and how it functions, and there's been significant work already going on just with normal PennDOT improvements to the road, and the accident where this occurred actually took out some places that had just been improved. So the snarl-ups, the traffic jams that everybody was experiencing for those 2 weeks, my district, Representative Gallagher's district, they have been going through those same snarl-ups still because we don't have access to some of our normal entrances and exits off of 95. So I'm very happy that this is being proposed so that we can continue that work apace and get it done so that we can also then focus on all of the rest of the improvements to 95, which are still to come. So thank you again, and just a real serious shout out to all of the engineering that went into making this happen, all of the hard work of the building trades unions and the construction engineers who made it happen, and also, frankly, to the representatives and the senators and the governor for making this a priority, along with our federal partners who provided a lot of the funding that made it happen.
The chair thanks the gentleman. Any other comments or questions? Seeing none, may I ask if there are any negative votes on House Resolution 197? None here. We should have hearings and meetings more often in the city of brotherly and sisterly love. So with if there are no negative votes, House Resolution 197 is unanimously reported as committed. With that, if there are no other business before the committee, the meeting stands adjourned, and we will reconvene at 2 o'clock for our scheduled public hearing. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I call today's hearing to order, and I'll remind the members that this meeting is being live streamed. At this time, I'll ask our committee members to introduce themselves, starting from my far right side down to the left.
Representative Joe McAndrew.
Kyle Wagensell, Executive Director for the House Democrats.
State Rep. Kyle Mullins from Lackawanna County.
Kerry Benninghoff, Senator Mifflin County's and Minority Chairman.
Josiah Shelley, Executive Director for Chairman Benninghoff.
Good afternoon. Representative Donna Shuren from Montgomery County.
Representative Perry Stambaugh from the 86th District, Perry and Juniata Counties.
Representative Shelby Labs from the 143rd Legislative District in Bucks County.
Good afternoon. I'm Jen O'Mara from Delaware County.
Joe Hohenstein from right here in Philadelphia.
State Rep. Anthony Bellman from Philadelphia County, Alleyne, Longcrest, Lawndale, Oxford Circle.
Hello, Representative Gina H. Curry from the 164th District, and that is in Delaware County.
Steve Samuelson from Bethlehem up in the Lehigh Valley.
Thank you very much. We're also joined virtually by Representatives McNeil, Warren, and Cabell, and Representative DeVonzo. And with that, I welcome everyone to today's public hearing. I want to thank SEPTA, of course, for accommodating us today and letting the committee use their space. We will try to leave it in one piece. And we'll be receiving testimony on transit funding and the challenges we face as a Commonwealth going forward. After a very rocky past few years faced by transit agencies across the Commonwealth, big or small, and we should get right into the testimony of two outstanding two members. Actually, first and foremost, I want to ask Chairman Benninghoff, do you have any opening remarks for the hearing?
In the respective time, no. We'll just go ahead. I think there's a lot of good information, some great testifiers. I'd like to hear from them. Thank you.
Okay, our first panel includes the CEO for the two largest transit agencies in Pennsylvania. Leslie Richards is the CEO and general manager for the Southeastern Pennsylvania Transportation Authority. That's what SEPTA stands for all of you following along at home. And she's also the former Secretary of Transportation, so if I have it, call you Secretary, forgive me. Catherine Kellerman is the CEO of Pittsburgh Regional Transit, also known as PRT, and formerly known as the Port Authority of Allegheny County. Ms. Kellerman, thank you very much for being here as well. We welcome you both, and Secretary Richards, you may begin when you are ready.
Sure. Thank you so much. First of all, I want to welcome everybody to Philadelphia and to SEPTA. We truly appreciate you taking the time for us to discuss our challenges, our fiscal cliff challenges that are facing us. Good afternoon, Acting Chairman Mullins. Nice to see you. And, of course, great to see you, Minority Chairman Benninghoff, and every member of the committee. This hearing is extremely important, and we, again, thank you so much for holding it at this time. The funding challenges facing all of Pennsylvania transit agencies are really reaching a critical moment. As CEO and General Manager of SEPTA, I'm pleased to be joined today by my counterparts from across the state. Sitting next to me is my friend and colleague, CEO Catherine Kellerman from Pittsburgh Regional Transit. I'm happy to share this panel with her, and I know we also have Executive Director of Rabbit Transit, Rich Farr, here, as well as David Rochelle, Interim Executive Director and CEO for the Center Area Transportation Authority. All of today's witnesses bring unique perspectives on transit's critical role in mobility, equity, and opportunity. As a member of the Pennsylvania Public Transportation Association, SEPTA supports the association's funding principles and priorities, which include reforms to strengthen smaller and rural systems, local funding options legislation, and critically an amendment to the fiscal code to increase the allocation of state sales tax receipts to support transit agencies across the state. Please take what you hear today back with you to Harrisburg. As has been mentioned, I've spent a lot of time in Harrisburg talking about transportation and transit issues with many of you. And please urge your colleagues and leadership to address the challenges of transit funding now as budget-related bills continue to move. During your visit, you'll see a city and a region on the move from a SEPTA bus, and we are happy to provide this transportation for you as you enjoy the Philadelphia region. But we are moving differently in new patterns and to new destinations, and one constant always remains, that SEPTA service is the cornerstone of mobility in the state's most productive region. Later today, you'll visit the SEPTA Control Center. It's the nerve center of our operations and our virtual patrol center, where we are piloting artificial intelligence, gun detection technology, thanks to safety and security funding included in last year's state budget. So we want to thank all of you for that. And I have a few slides that I'd like to go through just because I'm able to show you some graphics and so that we can fully understand what's going on. And I didn't want to just read a testimony in front of you today. But before I start on my testimony hearing topic, I do want to briefly update you what we are doing here at SEPTA. We take safety and security very seriously. We've had a series of accidents recently, and we are working with the FTA and with PennDOT to improve our safety outcomes here at SEPTA. Just want to make you aware for that for the first time ever, we're doing training for every single employee, all 9,200 right now. And we are moving them through safety training where they can talk about any concerns that they have, be clear about how they report things, but also discuss what does safety mean for them. We want every single employee and every customer, when they leave the house, to go home in the same state. And so it is extremely important to us, and we are very, very happy with how this has been going. We're about halfway through. We have about 5,000 of our employees who have received this training, and it's so important to us that we actually decreased service and made sure that the training came first, and even though it impacted our service, but to get every single operator through this very important topic to make sure that everyone is focused on safety was a priority. So just wanted to let you know that that's going well. Happy to report back on that in detail to any of your staff or anyone who wants more information. I just would be remiss if I didn't touch on it before we went into our slides. So with that, let's go into our slides. Very briefly, as you know, it's already been mentioned, SEPTA is the largest transit agency here in the Commonwealth, and we are the fifth largest in the country. Just to let you know, around 9,000 employees, our operating budget just under $1.7 billion, our capital budget just under $1 billion. Even though we are operating right now at around 65% of ridership before the pandemic, I want to remind everybody, over 600,000 trips every day happen on SEPTA. It is huge. Just recently, we had the I-95. I saw many of you there when we had the I-95 collapse. And a fraction, less than 20% of those trips were taken on I-95 every day. And you see how serious that was? We were talking about over 100,000 trips on I-95 and how everyone gathered, spent money, got that highway back up. I just want to remind you that, you know, six times that amount of people are traveling on SEPTA every single day, and that we really want to see the investment equal to that amount and how important this is. I remind everybody about how many vehicles we have, nearly 3,000, how many routes, station stops. It is a big system, lots of people, lots of routes, lots of movement. Next slide. Also want to remind everybody, I know we've spoken in Harrisburg about this as well, we are one of the largest employers in the Commonwealth, not just in southeastern Pennsylvania. We are equal to a CVS or Aramark for the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. We are a large employer. For our system, we need materials, services, consultants from across the Commonwealth. We do business with over 40 counties, firms within over 40 of our counties. And always to remind everybody that 41% of the state's economic activity comes from southeastern Pennsylvania. That doesn't happen without a high-functioning SEPTA. We all care about the money coming into the Commonwealth, and we know that we need a highly productive southeastern Pennsylvania for that to happen. Next slide. This is a slide that is why we are here right now. We are on the brink, and this is why we are so grateful for your time today, because we are at a critical moment right now. This slide is showing the SEPTA operating budget as we run out of federal COVID money, which is shown in that light blue color there. The red hatch mark is showing where we have gaps. That is our fiscal cliff. That is the amount of money we are not sure where we are going to get it. We are asking for your help, and without it, we will not be able to operate. What we are looking at, I just want to point you to some bullet points on the right of that slide. Our board voted for the last time on a budget that did not have large fare increases nor significant decrease in service. We will not be able to do that next fiscal year, which starts July 1st of 2024, without some solution to our fiscal cliff. And so what we are looking at is fare increases up to 31%, which is huge, which an average salary of $50,000 for our riders, adding another dollar per ride is huge on their checkbook, you know, what money they can spend on their families. We're also looking at decreasing service by 20 to 30%. That also will impact people in really big ways. I do want to let you know that we have a new division here called our Transformation Office that has employee ideas. Our program there is looking at how we can be more efficient every single day. And we have already figured out ways to save over $30 million annually, and we continue to look for more ways to save money. We will continue to do that. And that's why we are not asking for the full $240 to $250 million gap that you see there on the red hash lines. But we need a significant portion of that, and we are hoping that you will work along with us to help with that unfunded gap. Next slide, please. So this is why we are here talking to you, and that is what we are looking at, and it's only going to get worse if we don't solve the fiscal cliff soon. So we are looking at, as I mentioned, service reductions, which will lead to job cuts, which will lead to fare increases, which will further reduce ridership if we're not a reliable way for people to get around. We're looking at our capital program suffering as well. I'm going to touch on that very briefly, and all of the service cuts. And so just want to let you know all of the decisions that we will be coming in front of you and discussing if we cannot solve this fiscal cliff. Next slide. We wanted to put money amounts on this so you can understand. So with this spiral downward that we're talking about, it equates to over $250 million lost. And that is taking into account the income, sales, and business taxes. We have worked with eConsult, and we've come in front of you with a lot of these types of studies for us. So I just, again, want to draw your attention to that red block right there. What this means is fewer jobs, smaller tax base. It will result, again, in $254.7 million in lower tax revenues. We wanted to break that out to you so you fully understand. $134.3 million lost in income, sales, and business taxes, $125 million lost in property taxes, and another $8.4 million lost in real estate transfer taxes. So this is real money. On the next slide, we wanted to let you know what the cost of inaction looks like to our customers, to our residents, to the people who visit this region. We're looking at increase in traffic injuries and what that costs. We're looking at traffic fatalities and what that costs in addition to loss of life. We're looking at vehicle emissions and our environmental obligations and our clean air goals. We're looking at what it costs for people to maintain their own personal cars and how that's going to go up as well. And then we're also looking at on what the fare increases and how it's going to hit people's purses and wallets. So the total social cost comes to an additional $171.1 million. And so the next slide I want to bring up right away, because I want everybody to see this slide. And if there's one slide you take home with you today, this is one of them. And that's the fact that the total tax revenue loss to this region of $254.7 million annual, plus the total social cost of $171.1 million, that equals $425 million, which is much larger than the shortfall we are asking for you to help us fill. So that's $425 million cost, and we are asking for help, again, not the full amount, but we are asking for help to fill a $240 million shortfall. And you don't need to have a master's degree in business. You don't need to be an economist to understand that is a good deal, right? We want to help others, and we want your help as well. On the next slide, we just wanted to remind everybody, how can we help and how can we fill this fiscal cliff? We are in front of you with a proposal to increase the allocation in sales tax receipts in Pennsylvania from 4.4% to 6.4%. Why this 2% increase? It's going to provide an additional $295 million to the Public Transportation Trust Fund, the PTTF. We've talked about this many times, how we get our funding. And again, we're not asking for an increase in sales tax. We're asking for an increase in the allocation. And why this makes so much sense now is the equation I just presented to you. This is a good deal. It's an investment. You're going to see a lot of returns on it. But also, sales receipts are going up. They've gone up over the last few years. They will continue to go up for the next few years. And so this is why we think this makes a lot of sense as well. And I also want to remind everyone, this is not just an ask for SEPTA, but an ask for every single transit agency in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. 190 of that 295 million will go to SEPTA. Pittsburgh Regional Transit will get 66 million, and then 39 million will be distributed to the other 53 transit agencies in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. On the right side, I just wanted also to highlight what other state legislatures have done, what other governors have done. So we've seen it in California, and I've seen it in my conversations with my colleague who runs BART over in San Francisco. We've seen it in New York, and I've seen it with our colleagues over at the MTA. And we've seen it in Boston, and we've seen it with our colleagues at MBTA. Other states are realizing how important transit is and how they need to invest in going forward. Next slide, I've brought up to you before, but also just want to show we have capital program needs too, but we do not believe, and I know many of you don't as well, in raiding our capital budget to pay for our operating budget. We are very proud at SEPTA to be able to say we have never done this and we don't plan on doing it in the future. Frankly, we can't afford it because our state of good repair is at $5.1 billion. Our system, many of it, is over 100 years. In fact, CNN just ran a story on the 10 oldest transportation systems. We are one of them. Chicago, New York, and SEPTA are the only American transit systems on that list. You'll know others, London, Paris, Istanbul, believe it or not, is on that list as well. But this is a very old system, and we want to do the best to maintain it so that it can be utilized. On the right is a graphic that was put out by Chicago in a memo to their state legislature to show that they needed more funding, more investment. They pointed out that there are two agencies that are funded less than theirs, And we are the least. We are the least of these major agencies. And quite frankly, you know, while it's embarrassing, and I can tell you over and over again that we are the least, but I don't think anything says it as strongly as when another transit agency is trying to make the case, and they are showing that we are actually under, we are being invested in even less than they are. So please take a look at that. And then I just want to end with this slide, which is just a summary of the points that we've brought up. And I look forward to any questions or answers and answering any questions that you may have. But urgent action is needed. Again, this is our last operating budget without significant fare increases as well as decreases in service unless we address this fiscal cliff. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Secretary. Catherine Kellerin, you can start your testimony whenever you like, and once your testimony is finished, we will then open it up for questions and remarks with the panel. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Acting Chair. I am on. Okay. Thank you. Good afternoon, Acting Chair Mullins, Chairman Benninghoff. Good to see you again, and members of the House Transportation Committee. I am Catherine Kellerman. I have the distinction of being the coolest CEO, not really, the CEO of Pittsburgh Regional Transit over in Pittsburgh. Thank you for letting us join you today and talk about the fiscal issues, which are certainly here in Philadelphia, but also in Pittsburgh and York and Erie and throughout our Commonwealth. We are not number 5, which is SEPTA. We are number 20 in the U.S. We have 2,600 employees. Our operating budget this year is about $534 million. Our capital will be about $150 million. So much smaller than SEPTA, but still the 20th largest in the nation. And I think that highlights how much of the economy and the success of the Commonwealth has come from transit, not just in Philadelphia or Pittsburgh, but throughout the entire region. Our 2,600 employees operate 700 buses, 80 rail vehicles, the 153-year-old Mon Incline. Please come visit. If you have kids with you, they'd love to watch it. And if you like watching gears and very big wires, you'd probably like to watch it too. We still operate on about 120,000 rides every single weekday. We transport folks all throughout our county. We also operate our access system through contract. And that provides life-altering transportation to folks with disabilities or folks going to dialysis or folks who are on senior transportation. So we absolutely make life happen for Allegheny County. We've absolutely benefited from a long relationship with the Commonwealth to fund transit and transportation in our county. But we also generate local revenue through fares and through advertising. In March 2020, when our ridership dropped by 90%, so did our fare revenue. We've recovered to about 60 to 65% of ridership, and our fare revenue is there too. We're still missing that gap on fare revenue. And nothing has gotten cheaper in the past 4 years. In fact, nothing has gotten cheaper since 2011, which is when we went to when we came up with Act 89. Thank you so much for everyone who was in the legislature for that support. For those who were not in the trenches, that was a 10-year-long temporary funding solution. We were always going to have this conversation. So while our funding might not be at the levels of SEPTA, we will be at a cliff in a few years. And we were always going to have this conversation. Regardless of the pandemic, we've always been in a temporary, in the past 10 years, it's been a temporary level. And while every other cost has gone up, our funding has not. So we do talk a lot about how the pandemic has upended transit or commercial real estate or even grocery shopping. That's true. But we were going to have this conversation. Like SEPTA, PRT has relied on federal funds to offset annual revenue shortfalls, but again, it's only temporary. We're in the same ocean, but maybe just on different boats, and we're all in it together. The need for dedicated, sustainable, and growing funding for transit statewide remains paramount. In time, all of our transit systems here in the Commonwealth will hit this wall, not just Philadelphia, not just Pittsburgh, but our friends in York and Center County, our friends throughout the entire Commonwealth will hit this wall. It isn't just a problem for bus riders or rail commuters. It will impact our major employers, our business owners, and our developers as well. The state of our post-COVID economy is a pressing concern for Pittsburgh, just as it is in Philadelphia or Scranton or anywhere. And when we are looking at how to be attractive for new companies and new businesses and new residents, We're not hearing from folks who want to get back into their cars. We're not hearing from businesses that are looking forward to take advantage of huge parking garages. People are still looking for us to build our economy by connecting folks where they live to the places that they want to go now. They don't want to get back in those cars. In many cases, we don't have that capability. There are still more jobs in downtown Pittsburgh than parking places. There are more people in the Oakland area than available parking. Simply put, getting rid of any level of transit chokes the economic drivers that are in our regions. By bolstering transit funding today and providing opportunities for our vital systems to grow, we are investing in our region's abilities to thrive economically and compete. Like SEPTA, we are also focused on the future. We're using this moment to consider where our transit really should be. In many cases, our routes haven't moved in 60 years. Some have been on the same path since 1859. Okay, that's just one route, 91 on Butler Street. But as our regions move, it's time for us to move too with them and consider how we meet these challenges. We spent a chunk of the last decade working within the limits of our budgets, economizing, freezing salaries, not expanding service, reducing benefits, and we know what happens to our service in our regions when we don't invest. That is not an option for us to go back to anemic service where we're not attractive as an employer and we're not attractive as a service provider. We're already planning for the future by looking at internally how we structure. Externally, we've kicked off route restructuring for the entire region. We're introducing new routes in downtown starting in October. We authored our long-term plan in 2020, so we haven't had to catch up from COVID. We're already ready to face these challenges, but we need adequate funding to do so. Maintaining funding even at today's levels are not sustainable. Bridges that were $55 million to repair in 2020 are now $80 million. And we have 79 bridges and 11 tunnels that we maintain. Many of these don't even have transit services. The healthcare that our employees require to be able to live their best lives has exceeded the growth of sales tax, cost of doing business, and electric. We simply cannot live within the budgets which are set for yesterday's level of service when we're facing the challenges for tomorrow. Again, thank you for letting us come visit you today. We generate about $1 billion impact in our region, again, smaller than SEPTA, but still significant for the Commonwealth, and I look forward to any questions that you have.
Thank you, Ms. Kellerman. Now I would ask the members if they have any questions for either or both panelists. Representative Holmstein.
Thank you, Chair, and I'm going to start by just saying that as many in this room know, I am an unabashed fan of SEPTA and mass transit. I've ridden the system since I was a child, and I absolutely believe that when you move 600,000 people a day, we need to make sure that we take care of you. If you want to compare that, there are 63 counties of our 67 counties in Pennsylvania that have fewer residents than 600,000, including yours, Fair County of Delco. So we've got to make sure that we're protecting you. And I also want to give a quick shout out to the fact that, Leslie, you addressed safety concerns first, and that is a major issue for us in the city. And I have spoken with different folks who are working on a lot of the safety initiatives that we have, in particular in some of my neighborhoods around the Frankfurt L. And I appreciate that of all of our city agencies or governmental agencies, SEPTA has been at the forefront of working on those issues. I want to ask you, Leslie, if you could pull up the slide that talks about how SEPTA and the Southeastern PA drive the statewide economy. Mm-hmm. Because I want to make sure people understand that the investment that we make in a transit system for the southeastern corner of the state drives so much of other counties and other regions' economies. Northampton is getting $75 million a year from SEPTA contracts. And Blair County is getting over $4 million a year. So these are things that are happening far outside of the service area of SEPTA, and they do help to drive the economy. My question, and in the request that you are making of us, that request would not meet the actual budget shortfall. By the numbers that we were seeing, you're asking the state to come up with $190 million. The shortfall is $240 million for the SEPTA system. I've been out in Pittsburgh, and I love your system as well, but I got to pay attention to my home ground. But so how is SEPTA managing or planning to address the other shortfall?
As many of you know, I left a job that I loved to come here to SEPTA, and I worked with you. I was thrilled to be the Secretary of Transportation for the Commonwealth. The reason I did that is because I was very proud of how SEPTA had managed its budgets. There are a lot of transit agencies across the country that I would never consider going to. But they have been so fiscally responsible. Right, as I said, they always use their capital money for capital money. They always use their operating money for operating money. And they have always looked for innovative ways to raise revenue. So we want to be part of this solution as well. We are not just looking for others to bail us out. Trust us. And so I already mentioned the transformation office, where we are going through so many employee-led ideas and figuring out ways that we can be better. That we can do things more efficiently. We also have started a SEPTA Key Advantage program, which has been, so far, very successful. We have the largest public employer as well as the largest private employer here already enrolled. We have over 60,000 riders, or I should say employees of Philadelphia, and what that is a program where we work with employers to help them. They get a discounted rate on SEPTA. They still pay, by the way. This is not a free service, but they get to pass it on as a free benefit to their employees as they're figuring out their return to office plans, as they're figuring out how to get their employees back to work. And it has been hugely successful. In fact, we just signed our first university, which is Swarthmore. Yes, I am looking at Representative O'Mara there. Thank you for all your help in getting that through. So we're hoping that universities take advantage of this as well. And why this is really exciting for us. Right now it's budget neutral. We price it out. We use the same firm that helped us with these economic numbers that we've given you. We figured out what is budget neutral. We want to give everybody the best deal they can have without SEPTA losing money. But as more and more employers sign on, SEPTA will start to make money on this. So we are counting on money coming in, and it also has helped us increase our ridership. When you receive riding on transit as a free service, guess what we are finding, and that's you use us more. It's not just to come into your office, but it's to have dinner afterwards. It's to meet people before. It's to bring your family in on the weekend. And we are seeing every single member of this program using our system more. In fact, I believe it was over an extra 10 trips a month they are taking. And it is significant. And obviously, the more people we have, the safer people feel, and the better reliability on our system as well. So that is part of it. We also have station namings. As you know, we have Jefferson Station, we have NRG, we have our new Wawa station. That's also a source of income. So we're going to continue to look for other ways to raise money, but we know we can't make up that 240. We are working really hard, and I can't say that we have fully figured out that $60 million gap right now, but we know we can do it, and so we're asking for help for the 190.
Thank you.
Representative Curry, followed by Representative Samuelson.
Thank you, Acting Chair. So I just want to say, Leslie, that I applaud you for putting the safety training in place. We know that there's been numerous issues that have plagued the transit system. Having people, I saw that
you know, that you stated 65% of ridership since before the pandemic, that's still awfully low, and we know that that's hurting SEPTA. Mm-hmm. So I really applaud you on that, getting that in, because I know, you know, there's a lot of things that come back from the operators, you know, and the folks that are operating the vehicle, you know, the transit as well, with fear around safety and the riders. So the one slide that really caught my attention was the cost of inaction to customers, residents, and visitors. Being with 69th Street right in my district, mm-hmm. I know that we've been talking about various things that we can do to increase safety around those areas. But the one part that I thought about that I don't know if it's on here was about school-age children and ridership, because we know in the city of Philadelphia, they heavily depend on SEPTA to get back and forth to school. So do you have any comments on how that would be impacted? Because when I think about the schools, you know, what costs, we were just in a presser yesterday on the underfunded conditions of schools. Mm-hmm. And when you think about transportation, a lot of the suburban schools and out in the other parts of the Commonwealth are suffering with bus driver, vacancies. So how do you think that's going to impact SEPTA? Because I don't see it on here, and I just, it's something that's always on my mind when it comes to education.
Of course. And it's on our mind as well. So in the Philadelphia School District, we are their transportation for 65,000 of their students on a regular basis. And we know that lots of students depend on us for after school activities as well. As you all may or may not know, you know, children 12 and under ride our service for free. If you're a student in the Philadelphia School District and need us for transportation, you get a free pass as well to use us for school. We also work with the school districts, and that's throughout the 5-county region. It's not just in Philadelphia. It's in Delaware County as well, Montgomery County, Bucks, obviously, Chester. All five of our counties, we work closely with law enforcement, with school transit as well, police, because, you know, schools can also, students can cause disruptions on our system, so I just would be remiss if I didn't mention that as well. But we take that very seriously, and in that safety training, we purposefully were very aggressive with the first 4 weeks, because we knew that we had 4 weeks before school started, and we wanted to get every single operator that would be carrying our school children and all of our customers through that safety training before the school children were on. And that's why we were so aggressive in the beginning. We will continue. And now we're hitting a variety of other positions as well. So yes, we are very much in tune. We meet with school groups all the time. We attend meetings to see what we can do to make sure that our students can get to where they need to be and get the best education for them. Thanks.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to for our committee to talk to you directly about transit funding. I want to start by saying thank you. My son lives in Philadelphia and does not own a car, thanks to you and the buses and the trolleys and the regional rail and the bike share. I don't think you have anything to do with the bike share, but
I may have helped a little bit when I was on in my last job.
Well, I appreciate that. I want to go back to your chart about the region on the brink with the projections for the up till 2029. So there's the light blue, which is the federal COVID money, which is going away after fiscal year 24. Mm-hmm. At the top, there's the dark blue, which is other federal funding. And it looks like in 2019 and 2020, the federal commitment to transit was higher than what you're projecting for 25, 26, and 27. What is that in raw numbers, and also how is your outreach to our federal partners of basically asking, you know, why that's down post-COVID?
I can get you that detailed numbers, but I know our federal funding goes up when we're able to make local matches and compete for competitive grants. That's a big piece of why we would get more in 1 year when we would get those grants, because the rest is federal, is formula. So that would be there. And I'd also, I wanted to point out, while we are definitely talking about fiscal cliff, which is operating, I really appreciate your question because it allows me to highlight our capital needs as well. And I just read over this weekend, and while I'm so happy for our colleague Dorval Carter over in Chicago, they just received $2 billion from the federal bill, IIJA, because they had $2 billion to put up in local matches for their red line. As you know, we had to put on pause our King of Prussia extension because we did not have the $1 billion needed. I so wished I would be in front of you right now that when they gave that money out, they would also be giving us $1 billion to $2 billion for that project. But we can't compete. And so that's part of why the federal funds, you know, go up and down. I obviously wasn't here in 2019 and 2020, so I'll let our staff fill, you know, that information if there's additional reasons. But I do believe it's the competitive grants that really make that difference, and we want to be competitive. And so what I hear from our federal delegation is, look, we did our part. We made these federal competitive grants available in higher numbers than ever. That's what this administration has done. But here in Pennsylvania, we can't compete for it because we don't have, you need a 50% matching grant for transit. That's part of the, I feel, the inequities of how we fund transit versus how we fund highways. We didn't need that high of a match, by the way, when we were on the talking about DOT issues and highways and bridges, but we need it for transit. And so that is why we're in front of you. And I just want to remind everyone, we do have a local funding bill in front of you, which will allow our local counties to help us come up with those matches, which we desperately need. So thank you very much for that question.
Gotcha. Is that the Representative Waxman's bill?
Correct. Well, I believe there's two bills. There's one in the local government committee, and then there's one in the transportation committee. So there's two in that form. We're hoping one of them, we need one of them to get out of committee, and then we can have the fuller discussion and vote on that. But I also want to remind everybody, as Catherine could also remind everybody, this federal bill is only good for 5 years. And every hour we waste discuss, we've already given up 3 years of competitive grants. Those grants are out there every single year. You can get $500 million a year if you can just compete. You can get more than that. But we are giving this up. And so we're now entering the third year of this five-year bill. So the sooner we can have these discussions, and if Pennsylvania would like to take advantage of these federal dollars, again, once in a generation money, we need that those local matching funds sooner than later.
And my second question is about the green part of your graph, which is the revenue from fares. The projection looks like you're projecting an increase through 2029, but still less than 2019. What was the rider, to compare the 660,000 daily trips now, what were the daily trips back in 2019 before the pandemic?
Yeah, we were about 1 million. We were at about 1 million a day, a little over on some days, a little under on some days, and now we're at 600,000.
And so down about a third at this point. How does that compare with transit agencies around the country?
We're probably in the middle. There are some transit agencies that are doing better. I'll let Catherine talk about where Pittsburgh is. I think we're right in the middle of where transit agencies are.
And thank you, Representative, and thank you, Secretary Leslie. that we are at about 65% as well. What we've seen around the U.S. are agencies that had more discretionary riders, more people who were commuting. They've had a smaller portion of their folks come back in that commute market. But you may have seen more people coming back late night weekends. That's definitely what we've seen. So we've seen a shift from those commuters into folks who are going to the grocery stores again, or folks who are visiting mom and going to church. Systems where you might not have seen as much of a drop, or places where you're more likely to wait an hour between buses. And so the folks who were using were the folks who had no other option. We're really fortunate both in Pittsburgh and Philadelphia that the quality of service is good enough that just like your son, folks can choose not to have that car. But if we can't keep that plentiful service out there, it will force them back into their cars. And thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Representative McAndrew.
Thank you for having me in your fine city. I'm not going to talk about any Super Bowls today, but I hope that you guys pick it up this year. Because we're not.
The chair grants a do over there, Joe.
Anyways, so I'm here today. One of the things that I think was very interesting in your testimony was specifically about operating budget and operating funding. Now, wages and employment are in the operating budget, correct?
Yes, sir.
So are you seeing a struggle with recruiting workers, keeping workers on? You know, has that been with... Currently, is it a struggle, and do you project it to be a further struggle if you don't receive these funds?
Well, Representative, let me start with I wore black and gold because I'm a sucker for punishment. Yeah, well, just kidding, but thank you. I will say for us, the wages are, I mean, obviously they're a component, but this is a tough job. I don't know the numbers exactly for SEPTA, but at many agencies, you might go 5 years without getting a holiday that you're not working, right? And that's a tough sell. Now, we have attractive wages. In our market, you'll make $22.60 an hour once you finish training as an operator. When we are not in the top 10, we're in the top 15 nationally for almost every single one of our labor categories. And our city is not the 10th or 15th most expensive. Folks can earn same-day overtime. We have excellent health benefits. Everybody should have good health benefits, so it's not really much to brag about. And folks can still get a pension. Folks can still graduate high school at 18 and come to work and maintain it and do a vehicle for us and be eligible for a pension, right? But what folks are looking for is they want that weekend off, or they don't want that split shift, or it can be harder to employ on things which previously have been in the nature of the business for us. Now, we can always slice and dice our work to try to fit the workforce. If we can't make it, then we'll have less service out there. But if we can't hire up, the only thing we can do is make that shift longer. And you know, going from an 8.5 hour day to a 9 hour day might not sound like a lot, but that's a 9 hour day. Making sure you're hitting a time point every 7 minutes, which I can't do in my day, meeting 5,000 new people going through all sorts of different parts of the city. And let's face it, folks aren't as, we're losing our social contract. Folks are meaner than they used to be. So even in just a nutshell, it's a hard job to hire for. It is not an easy position. We in Pittsburgh face a very different environment with our ridership and in our downtown, and we have a different system, but it's still a challenge, and that goes back to if the service isn't out there, who's going to take it, then we're not hiring. It becomes a chicken and an egg on that one, absolutely. Do you want to add anything?
Yeah, we're also having a hard time. We're having a hard time attracting new employees and retaining as well. Not having... our operating budget solid. We are entering into negotiations with our largest union right now, TWU, and it makes it really difficult. It makes it difficult to say, yes, we're going to be able to give you this type of a wage increase, not knowing that we will have enough money in our operating budgets that's not going to lead to fare increases, decrease in service, and job cuts. And so, having this operating budget, and that's why we are concentrating, even though our capital budget needs are really big here, we are concentrating on operating budgets. We need to invest in our people. We know that is who makes us SEPTA and who makes us successful. And so we really need this operating budget relief to know that we have a solid operating budget for years so that we can give our best contract to those who make our system work, which are our hourly workers who come in every day.
Chair thanks the gentleman and recognizes Chairman Benninghoff before proceeding to our second panel. Thank you.
Thank you both. Nice to see both of you again and have you here before us. You present difficult challenges for yourselves and are sharing them with us. Your difficult challenges, I'm the last one to ask questions, so my pen has been going feverishly. The good thing is hopefully I won't be able to read most of my own writing. Three things specifically. We talked about the $240 million request. One, just for clarification, that's on the annual basis of need. It's not a one-time hit, give you a boost, and then hope things get better, correct?
Correct.
second question has to do, and Representative Samuelson started touching on it. You know, in the rural areas, you know, for those that have some transit authorities as well, you know, adjusting fares is never popular anywhere. But, you know, I look at the green bar in your graph, and it's pretty consistent over the time. The state and local subsidy on your graph, while not where you may want it to be, seems to still increase over the years. I guess the question I have is, if your numbers at 65% from pre-COVID for the SEPTA program, around 50 for Pittsburgh, if you were to be back exactly where you were pre-COVID, where would your shortfall be? Because there's other factors, I think, that are weighing in on. Is that?
I can, for us, we would still have all the capital needs. Just to remind everybody, Catherine had mentioned Act 89. And so Act 89, back in 2013, SEPTA's capital budget was $300 million. Act 89 got us to $600 million. Recently, we've been able to borrow on the money that comes to us from PennDOT, because now we're getting money from the vehicle sales tax, thanks to all of you last year, by the way.
Right.
And so we're very grateful for that. We were able to borrow another $500 million, which got us to close to $1 billion in our capital budget. That graph I showed you from Chicago, just to let you know, their capital budget on an annual basis is $2.5 billion. Boston's is $2 billion. We are less than half of most of our colleague legacy systems, so we are really operating. But your question is on our operating side. So our revenues from fares prior to the pandemic made up 37% of our operating budget. Right now, they're about 20%. That amount is a little over $200 million. So if we had the ridership that we had before the pandemic, we would not be facing this fiscal cliff. What COVID-19 federal relief money did is it allowed us to operate at a reliable level so that people would continue to use us and how they need us while our ridership was so low. So that ridership is key. And that's how we were, that's how we programmed, that's how we strategized around that ridership. So without that ridership, that's where we're having that gap. So that's why we're working very hard to increase that ridership.
And Chair, if I may, Act 89 also provided capital funding throughout the entire Commonwealth. So parceled out differently. As envisioned with Pittsburgh, in that 10-year window of Act 89, the first 3 years we would be sinking extra money in the bank. So we would get $75 million a year from Act 89 funding and add $15 million of a local match, so a total of 90. The first 3 years, we would bank it. The middle 4 years, we would tread water and spend it. The last 3 years, we would spend it all out. And at the end of Act 89, which would have been 2 years ago, we would have had less than 10% of an annual budget in the bank for reserves. We would have been absolutely in the red. To avoid that, we took a lot of economizing measures through the 10 years of Act 89. We cut back on both operating and capital to make sure we could make it to the end of that window. And that is why from 2010 through 2017, our budget was flat. It fluctuated within a $5 million window. That was a 7% service reduction. That closed a garage. That got rid of a lot of benefits for our staff. It was a 4-year freeze for the non-bargaining folks who worked for the agency, and much smaller raises than our unions would have liked in that window. So to live with the numbers, even from Act 89, involved us getting out less service than we would have anticipated. And now we're still at a lower number than we would have projected on that. When it comes to capital, our capital budget normally is about $120 to $150 million a year. We have over $4 billion in assets. Our rail cars are 37 years old. It will cost us about $400 billion to replace these rail cars. And unlike bus support or new rail cars from the jump, there's not a separate bucket of money. We will have to bond to be able to buy the new rail cars. PennDOT study from 2019-2020 identified over $300 million in improvements needed to upgrade our Silver Line. It's completely safe, but we have switches that are old enough that they're interoperable with the folks at the Pennsylvania Trolley Museum. That feels cute, but not efficient, effective, or where we want to go. We have bridges from 1915 on the Silver Line, and again, that's a $300 million investment just to modernize it. We don't even have the money for that. our long-term maintenance facility must be replaced. All jokes aside about asbestos, I wouldn't take a sticker off the wall in that building. And for a future where we want to save air quality, we cannot do heavy maintenance on buses if we can't retrofit for either electric, which is a lot of charging infrastructure, or adding hydrogen, which is a different fuel technology, different parts, different fluids, and different air circulation. So we can't be ready for the future without that just as a capital. Now, if our ridership was the same as it was pre-pandemic, fares would be about 20% of our budget. They're about 12% of our budget today. If it were pre-pandemic, I would be sitting in this chair telling you that I can't add any more service because I have no room at my garages. Our East Liberty bus garage was built for 200 buses. It currently houses 240. So when it's rainy and snowy, we play this little rotating game of which bus gets to stay inside. Our rail cars are old enough that we will park them and part them out because the parts are no longer made. A benefit of rebranding is if you've seen our trolleys, they're white with little stickers on them. Those stickers were last made in 2002, and they're no longer adhesive. We can't put stickers on our trains because they are that old. So I'd be coming to you talking that we can't meet the need in Pittsburgh if those folks were all still riding with us. I could show you a bendy bus at 3 p.m. on a Wednesday with 120 people. So that's 70 people sitting and 50 people who have their butts in somebody's face, realistically speaking. I would argue that that sounds like we're really busy, but that's a failure of policy. That means we don't have enough buses to meet service. During COVID, we had a significant crunch because we did, you know, social distancing. We had neighborhoods that resulted in losing half their capacity, and they were transit-dependent neighborhoods. So we would be talking about different funding issues, but we would still be talking to you about the inability to give folks the service that they deserve.
Thank you both for those answers on that. I guess the question that was proposed to me earlier was about, you know, why isn't this kind of a bill easily passed, and why can't we just get these new opportunities to try to raise revenue? There's only about two people probably sitting here who voted on Act 89, and for those that were in the middle of their careers thinking, good, that's the last big transportation bill I'm going to have to vote on, some of which probably said that 10 years before that in the last one, you know, they feel like they're on Groundhog Day. At a time where I realize prices are going up, the question I will be up front and say to you, a lot of the rural members are asking, well, what are they doing about raising their fares? How much are the fares going up? And I'm looking at these graphs, it doesn't give me any numbers. But, you know, the other day I bought a half a gallon of milk and almost had a stroke at $3.59 a gallon, half a gallon. To the person who asked me this question earlier, and for your sake, I have a lot of conversations with a lot of members from different geographic areas. And, you know, they're concerned when they see buses, whether it's in Harrisburg or Reading, Scranton, going by with two or three people on them. That's their perception of mass transit. It's hard to get them excited about wanting to fund that. I'm being upfront with you. Madam Secretary, you and I talked in the past openly in a public meeting, and we talked about the crime issue. You know, sadly, they hear about that. You have a DA who's not as excited about doing some of the things that some of the rest of us feel that they ought to be doing as far as prosecuting this crime to try to reduce these things. So I guess, again, for people who eventually who have to cast 102 votes in the House and 26 in the Senate on any issue, you've got to convince them of why you want to get there. These other issues, I will be upfront with you, are in the forefront of many of our rural members. I can't make that a vote again. Why do you want me to be voting for another financial investment package when X, I, Y, Z are a problem? And, you know, lastly, you know, we rode down on the train today, and I debated whether in some of it's for convenience. Pittsburgh, I don't do that because I drive. That way I can run around and see all my grandkids. But I'll be honest with you, I do the math, and for me to use the gas to come down and then park my car into a hotel for $35 or $40 a night, that's $120 if I stay here for 3 nights. Maybe those are something that can be adjusted. I don't know that. I don't know where that money goes into the hotel and the hospitality industry, but that seems like a lot of money to be parking a vehicle. Again, in rural Pennsylvania, we park in big parking lots, and generally they aren't charged for that. But these are the challenges for the reasons you have to try to get the votes out, and I'm probably being more candor than some people may want me to be, but I think we have to be realistic about why this is not just simply put a bill up and let's vote for it. Today's votes look pretty simple because they're dealing with relatively simple issues. lastly, I have to just ask quickly. I know you had some issues with the electric buses. I've seen that you're going to be going to some of the diesel hybrids. I actually always felt that that was a better opportunity to go. I guess the question is, do we isolate the ones that are completely electric away from the other ones per chance that they have problems? Or they're not parked in the same garage as everybody else?
So the issues that you end up seeing with the charging will usually be some of the in-ground chargers, some of the battery technology that folks had been working on. And the vehicles, more of the manufacturers that had the problems are either ones that we are not doing as much business with or not doing business with them at all.
Right.
As Leslie started off with, safety is absolutely the first thing that we have to look at. If there's any reason, if we see a thing for us to be concerned about for any type of vehicle, whether it would be a diesel bus that might smell funny, or a vehicle where the engine is running hot and you don't know really what's going on, we would obviously always move that away outside. The vehicles that we are working with specifically, we are not seeing things which come back within those tolerances. That doesn't mean that there aren't crazy accidents that go on out there, but we are also, you know, there's different safety measures that go in if we were looking at compressed natural gas. There are different safety measures that go on with hydrogen. So any technology we look at, you got a big engine around something that can be particularly dangerous. So our industry spends an awful lot of time on safety to make sure that it's realistically safer to be at a bus garage than it is to be in your own garage. Maybe just my garage because of how my children park their bikes. I don't mean it that way. But there is so much that goes into safety because, again, if our folks don't feel comfortable coming to work, nothing else we're doing is worth it.
Fair enough.
Yeah, and I know we've had this conversation. Just to remind again your colleagues in Harrisburg about the $1.5 billion that went into the Pennsylvania economy just from SEPTA alone. If we added it all up, it would be more significant. It's not just these five counties. It is 40 counties of the 67. And also all of the, again, just to remind you, all of what could be lost as far as what's coming out of southeastern Pennsylvania. I know that they care about efficiency. I know they care about good investments. I know they care about businesses. And so, you know, it makes a lot of sense if they want a healthy, vital economic state that they invest in transit. The business model is there. And, you know, I'm always willing to come out and talk to you about it.
Well, and I appreciate, again, and appreciate you accepting me being candid, but I want to have dialogues that are not just fluffy and tell everybody how much we love each other, but... You know, I'm very supportive of your systems. I think it's important what we do. And, you know, when in my former role, I try to remind proportionally what amount of the economic development occurs in these urban regions, too. And you can't look just an isolated situation. Yes, there's higher cost factors, but what's the benefit of that? And if we're honest with ourselves, the majority of our economic development and money that's raised by the state itself comes out of more of the urban areas. But I think it's important that you also see that for us to get 102 votes, and for us those, and I'm looking at some of my friends in back who have had to count votes, they get these skewed perspective because they see or they read one article about an incident that happens, you know, whether it's a crime issue, whether it's a bus on fire, whether it's a DA who doesn't do what they think their DA would do, and that locks their opinion. Some won't come down. You know, I've tried telling about some of the neat things going down here. Obviously, there's a recent Faith Liberty Center recently, beautiful facility, fun, exciting testament to our history. I can't encourage them to come down to see these things. I want them to do that. I want them to see what a great state we have in this Commonwealth. So thank you for your comments, and thank you for your patience, Mr. Chair.
Chair, thanks. The chairman, final question is Representative O'Mara.
Thank you, and I will be brief because I do know that we are behind schedule. I just wanted to... first, thank you both for being here and acknowledge how exciting it is to see two women in powerful roles like this. I also wanted to mention, as a SEPTA rider for 7 years, you know, I was the textbook example of someone who lived in Delaware County, utilized the system, paid a monthly pass to avoid parking at Penn, and then used that system at night to go for Wednesday Center City Sips and, you know, all the other reasons. And I just, you know, I understand what you're saying, Mr. Chairman, but as a member from the suburbs, sometimes I don't understand investments that rural members ask me to make. And so I think it's really incumbent upon us on this committee to make our colleagues understand why investing in public transit is investing in every single person in this Commonwealth. And public transit is in all 67 counties. It may look different here, but all of our constituents are using it. So I just, I felt really important to say that. I've learned a lot about rural Pennsylvania and why investments there make no sense to me, but why they're important. So I hope we can lead together on this committee. And I'm not saying you aren't by any means. I just wanted to end on that note. Thank you.
Chair, thanks to representatives, and of course to you, two outstanding professionals, for what you do day in and day out. But the committee also thanks your workforce, who you mentioned, of course, are doing very tough jobs, from your operators to your maintenance workers to your police officers. They are all interacting with people who are having the very best to the very worst days. So these are tough jobs, and you both you have tough charges, but we will do our very best to be responsive to what we heard today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and just a matter of housekeeping, to avoid the irony of a government hearing train, so to speak, running off schedule at the SEPTA headquarters, we'll ask for our next panels and member and questions to be as brief and concise as possible. As you know, as COVID dollars decrease, this is not just the SEPTA or a PRT Pittsburgh problem. All transit agencies, mine included, in Lackawanna County, will be experiencing this, as well as all of our 67 counties. And that is a good segue into us welcoming Mr. Rich Farr, the Executive Director of Rabbit Transit, which serves York and Adams counties. He is here on behalf of the Pennsylvania Public Transportation Association, and David Rischel, who is the Interim Director and CEO for Center County's Center Area Transportation Authority. Welcome to both gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, shall I lead off?
Go ahead, Rich.
All right. Good afternoon, Acting Chairman Mullins and Chairman Benninghoff and the members of the PA House Transportation Committee. I have written testimony, and I will try to make it brief. I'll highlight the most important parts. Based on the previous conversation, I would like to highlight that I began my career in Endless Mountains, Brefford, Tioga, Sullivan County, Brefford County being my home county, and my mother, after 20 years, still thinks at some point I'll move home again. But I now live in York, and our transit system is actually 11 counties, including Perry County, and so I have a pretty good understanding of what rural transportation looks like and the needs of rural transportation here in the Commonwealth. And so I'll talk a little bit about that. But today I'm actually here representing the Pennsylvania Public Transportation Association as the chairman of the Government Affairs Committee. PPTA represents 53 urban and rural transit agencies and community transit providers across Pennsylvania. And each of the 67 counties in Pennsylvania have some form of public transportation, connecting workers to jobs, students to education, seniors to vital services. Every trip on public transportation adds to the economy, makes transportation safer, more affordable, relieves congestions, gets Pennsylvania closer to achieving its sustainability and carbon reduction goals. I don't know if you know this, but PennDOT recently completed a study. It's titled Pennsylvania Investment in Public Transportation and Passenger Rail. And it's a very robust study. I recommend you go look at it. But there are two points that I pulled out for today that I think are relevant to the conversation. The first one is, for more urban areas in the state to remain centers of innovation and grow and compete with other states and regions for high-valued activity investment, it needs to support workforce transportation. I think that's pretty important based on the conversation we've been having up to this point through the question and answers. And for rural areas, transit-dependent populations, the service needs to be maintained to ensure independence and quality of life, ensuring seniors can age in place, medical appointments are not missed, providing employment connections for people with disabilities. All those result in reducing private and public costs to the community. So I think there are two important factors. Whether we're here in Philadelphia, you're talking about Pittsburgh, Perry County, Franklin County, transportation exists everywhere and throughout Pennsylvania is the engine of opportunity. The past few years have presented numerous challenges to transit. While the impact on the pandemic and Pennsylvania public transportation agencies have been varied as the regions that they serve, every transit provider faces fiscal challenges as federal COVID relief funds are expected to run out before ridership recovers. Each agency is on a different timeline. We heard about SEPTA, who you know historically relied heavily on their fare box revenue. For the largest portion of its operating budget, faces $240 million fiscal cliff beginning in July. Smaller agencies like ours have experienced budget impacts from inflationary pressures on labor, supplies, and insurances, creating deficits in different degrees of severity. And without legislative action, the remedies will all be similar across the state. Unsustainable service reductions, fare increases that will limit individual mobility and negatively impact economics, Pennsylvania's economic growth, and in short, Pennsylvania public transportation network is really at risk. To preserve transit operations across the Commonwealth, PPTA is supportive of a legislation designed to address its diverse funding challenges in a comprehensive way. Our members from rural, small urban, and large urban alike have all worked together the past several years to create legislation initiative that will modernize the management of our public transportation systems with a focus on capital funding predictability and ensuring funding is spent in a dedicated by local decision making. The results of our extensive collaborative work is reflected in Senate Bill 597, which has been introduced by Senator Dan Laughlin from Erie in the PA Senate, and additionally, Representative Ryan Bizarro, also from Erie, has circulated a co-sponsor memo introducing the companion legislation in the House of Representatives. I'd like to take the opportunity to encourage all of you to support this legislation by adding your name to as a co-sponsor to Representative Bizarro's bill. Senate Bill 597 has a whole host of what we think are benefits. It's in my testimony. I am not going to read them to you. I'll ask you to take a look at those. But we believe that the local predictability and capital planning will really help us advance public transportation in your communities. Again, for sake of time, PPTA is committed to a comprehensive approach to address the challenges facing our public transportation systems. Legislative efforts to adjust how the state sales tax receipts are allocated to public transportation by increasing the percentage of sales tax transfer from the current 4.4% to the 6.4% is an imperative component of any comprehensive solution. This change would improve every single Pennsylvania transit system's ability to meet the immediate and future operating needs. Additionally, PPTA supports the efforts of the two largest transit systems, SEPTA and PRT, and their advocacy for local revenue option to address those specific projects for this region or their regions. PPTA's support of a comprehensive approach to addressing the challenges facing public transportation mirrors the diversity of our membership. Whether it's rural, small urban, large urban, we will remain committed to the millions of Pennsylvanians who rely on transportation every day, because we know that every single ride matters. And so in conclusion, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to share some of my thoughts today and on behalf of PPTA, and look forward to any questions you may have.
Acting Chair Mullins, Chair Benninghoff, and ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the chance to come and speak with you today. I'm Dave Rischel. I'm the Acting Executive Director at CATA. And we're the transit system that serves the State College, Pennsylvania area, and also surrounding townships of Ferguson, Patton, College, and Harris Township, sorry. We also have some service out in further to the north, the community of Bellefonte, and two townships out there. And I promised Mr. Wagenseller last week that I wouldn't read remarks, so I'm going to try to be extemporaneous and brief here. So I just want to talk to you a little bit about our system and present you with some thoughts about what smaller transit systems in the state are facing. CATA is kind of unique in that we're a big little transit system. We serve an area that's only about 100,000 people, but in that area, we've had our annual service numbers as high as 7 million. We're one of the most efficient transit systems in the country in that our per capita service provision is very high, and that's because we not only serve the community, we also serve Penn State University. We do their shuttles on campus and all the service for them. In fact, we have one of our routes, just to give you an idea, that goes through a housing area. On a typical morning, we'll do 3,000 trips, 3,000 passengers into the university. So we really do mass transit at CATA, but we also do more suburban and more rural services. Our budget this past year is just under $26 million for this current fiscal year. But our ridership is down significantly from that peak of $7 million that we did long before COVID. And I want to talk a little bit about what we think is going on there and why that presents some challenges for us. And we think the same kind of challenges that are facing all of transportation in Pennsylvania. Ridership began to go down really before COVID-19. COVID-19 was kind of like the second punch. And we're not entirely sure why that is. When we take a look at our ridership and who's riding where, one of the things that has really changed things is the advent of TNCs, transportation networking companies. You know them as Lyft and Uber. And you know, they say, look, if you want to see the future, look at what the kids are doing. We've noticed some significant changes, a significant shift of rider preference to services like that, and they're kind of eating some of our ridership. So we started to see that kind of shift occurring before COVID, and then of course COVID hit us very hard. So our ridership now is down more than 20% what it was pre-COVID, and we're struggling to deal with those dual issues of trying to recapture rider preference and trying to compete with that immediate convenience of taking out your phone, calling for a ride, and boom, you get a ride. What we find is really interesting there is that it doesn't even seem to be that price sensitive. That people, young people, are making that choice. They're even willing to pay more with that convenience. So for public transit, it's kind of hard for us to deal with that and try to figure out how we're going to respond to that kind of a challenge. We're also facing some significant challenges with staffing. Our driver force was down significantly during COVID, and we're still only at about 90% of the driver force that we need. Of course, that's causing us to spend a lot of money on overtime. We are straining to meet our services, and we're frankly not sure how long we can continue to operate like this without considering wage increases, which we currently can't afford. We have our own fiscal cliff. Fortunately, we have a little bit of that blue area that SEPTA and Pittsburgh have, but our subsidies that we've husbanded fairly well look to run out in about 4 years. So we're also facing a fiscal cliff, and this year we have a budget deficit of $1.8 million, which we're able to cover, but we're looking very aggressively at what we can do to reduce our costs and to attract more riders. Because what's really interesting about the loss of ridership, it's not happening in a way that saves us any money. At the risk of sounding foolish and to be amusing, I think the ridership loss is a lot like the hair on my head. It's getting thinner, but there's no bald spots. So you can't really say there's no service here anymore, so we can cut it and we can save money. Everything is getting just a little bit thinner. So what we're simply doing by losing this ridership is losing revenue. We're not saving any money, we're just losing revenue. So we're taking a close look at how we can manage our services differently, how we can be more efficient. And getting to that rural piece, while the university-based services are extremely efficient, when we get out of the immediate State College area, if you've ever been up there, the demographics change very quickly. So the notion of the empty bus running around with nobody riding in it, we're trying to do more creative things like microtransit, which is a fancy way of saying smaller vehicles that may circulate, they may come whenever you call them. These are much less expensive than running a big transit coach through an area, but these services are still expensive. And they require electronic systems to help you manage them, which we can really no longer pay for with capital money because the days of going out and buying software in a box and setting up your computer are over. Everything is software and a service now, so everything has to be funded with operating dollars. So even though those do save us money, they cost us money in new ways that we haven't had to deal with before. So these are some examples of some things that that really are facing us, and any rural transit system in Pennsylvania is going to be facing similar things. We do want to thank both the legislature and PennDOT for the capital funding, which has been really tremendous. We operate a fully CNG fleet, And we save a great deal of money in fuel costs, really nearly $3 a gallon equivalent for what we would do for diesel fuel. So that's been a big cost savings for us. And we also appreciate what PennDOT has done in terms of electronic systems that enable us to provide information to our passengers about where the buses are and exactly when they'll get picked up. Going back to that TNC comment I made earlier, it's kind of rewired people that their expectation is, if I'm going to use your services, I want to know when that bus is going to be there exactly. And if we can't provide that information, they don't ride with us. It's really a whole different universe now, and it's the days of being able to just run a bus through town are over. If people are going to use public transit, we need to be able to respond to these new expectations, and that requires resources, which the state has provided, but of course everything we provide, they want more. So that's going to be a continuing expense in the future. So those are my remarks. Thank you very much. I'm happy to answer any questions. Please keep in mind, I'm the new kid. I've only been there since April, so I may not be able to answer everything. I'll do my best.
If I may, you don't seem new to the mission at all.
I've been around transit for a few years.
Your hair's covering just fine.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Keep it up. But I'll ask any members if they have any questions. Representative Hohenstein. No. Chairman Benninghoff.
Thank you. I too will be brief, but both of you did an excellent job. We appreciate you being here, and I think it's good to hear perspective from different size systems. Actually, David, you've made it so I really only have one question because you answered my other ones. But I thought your comment on the word rider preference, I think, is very important for us to think about, because I think it's significant reflecting on who's using these services and what their preference is. You know, I obviously live up around your area, and I see this. Penn State provided bus service for a long time. I don't know exactly why they went to you, probably from an efficiency perspective, but the question I was gonna add to that, and actually was gonna do in the last panel, is what do you think the impact for your ridership for the amount of people that still work from home?
It's been significant. We, as a specific example, since you know the area, we used to run a commuter bus from Bellefonte to downtown State College. Ran three times in the morning, three times in the afternoon. Prior to COVID, we had several hundred riders a day on that route. After COVID, it went down to a dozen. We're not sure why. We presume it's because people are working from home. We think a lot of the loss that we've had in ridership is because of remote work, remote classes, and people shifting over to TNCs to ride. And there's also this weird dynamic that as people work from home, there's less traffic on the road, so it becomes easier to drive. So people who might have taken us now consider driving because the streets aren't as busy, so it kind of feeds on itself.
And it's feeding from the businesses that are trying to save their own costs because the cost of prices are up, number of employees available to them are going down. This is a very compound conundrum, so I appreciate your candor.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you both very much for your work and your testimony. Thank you, Kyle.
Representative Samuelson, for a question, please.
Sure. Mr. Farr. North Central Pennsylvania. You mentioned about the senior trips, which of course go on all over the state. I'm just wondering, in your area, the 11 counties you serve, what percentage of the ridership is based on the senior trips, the van, door-to-door van service, and what is on more of a traditional bus route?
Yeah, so, and again, all of my counties are vastly different. So on average, on the shared ride program, if that's what we're talking about, in all the counties, it's about 60% seniors. And then it's about 20% persons with disability, and then the balance would be the Medicaid program and other contracts.
As opposed to other services on traditional bus routes, what?
Like, what is the senior ridership on regular?
If the ridership is 4 million a year, maybe
12,000 a day. What percentage are senior rides, and what percentage are traditional bus routes?
That's a great question. I can give you the answer. My gut would tell me about 25% is senior transportation. The lion's share of our transportation is folks going to work.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the members? All right. Thanks so much for your time and your testimony.
Thank you very much.
I'll now introduce our third and final panel. Mr. Paul Levy is the president and CEO of Center City District. Ariella Marone is the executive director of the Delaware Valley Regional Planning Commission. And Connor DeShemaker is the coalition manager for Transit Forward Philadelphia. We appreciate you being here, all three of you, and look forward to your testimony. All right, and we will, in order of introduction, we'll start with Mr. Levy.
Okay, thank you very much, and I very much appreciate the opportunity to testify and welcome all of you, Chairman, all members of the committee to Philadelphia. My name is Paul Levy. I'm the president of the Center City District here in Philadelphia. It is a large business improvement district, probably the largest in the Commonwealth and the largest in North America. And I represent a perspective of about 1,600 major property owners and 8,000 businesses. So I bring a private sector perspective to the value of public transportation to our Commonwealth. I'm going to rely completely on slides. I guess you have the half slide images, so they may not be as visible. I apologize for that. But if you simply look at that second slide, pre-pandemic, we had about 310,000 riders coming into Center City every day by public transit. And about 42% of all jobs here in the city are in Center City. Another 10% are in University City. So 8% of the land area, 53% of the jobs. If you look at the this is not moving forward, unfortunately. What do I need to point at? There it goes. Okay. This gave all our employers really access, a 360-degree access to employees within the region. This map on the bottom, I think, is really key, particularly for your son who gets along without a car. Every one of those dark green areas are places where 60 to 80% of people do not need a private car to get connected to transit. That's a to get connected to jobs. That's a huge advantage. I think the most important thing about the jobs that we have here in the downtown, just tell me what I need to point to. There it goes. It's just moving slowly. Okay. I think what we need to understand about the jobs here in Center City is 2/3 of our jobs do not require a college degree. That means they provide a huge amount of opportunity to semi-skilled and unskilled workers. For that reason, 25% of the working residents of every neighborhood in this city commute into Center City. At the same time, one of the great advantages we have here is more than 500 cultural institutions that really serve the entire region. And visitors to those institutions become patrons of restaurants, they become patrons of retail. And particularly, I'm really glad you enjoyed our Center City Sips promotion. You're here right now in the middle of our Restaurant Week promotion. I hope you can get reservations tonight, but we have extensive discounts. But this also provides jobs for restaurant and retail. If you go back, I apologize, this is just not moving very quickly at all. Could you? Okay, well, I'm going to talk really fast, so I'll just say next slide. Okay, go ahead, next slide then, please. The image on the bottom there simply shows you what we had in March. Next slide, please. Transit ridership simply dropped. Bottom slide there. We had a 74% reduction in pedestrians and people within Center City. Next slide, please. That represented for the city 126,000 job loss, 20,000 jobs lost in Center City. We went from a 88-89% retail occupancy rate down to a 54%. 4%. Next slide, please. At the top of this image is we are very far along in recovery in this city. We are back up to 89% of the volume of people in Center City that we had in 2019. If you look at the bottom graphic, our visitor numbers are incredibly strong. We are at 80% of pre-pandemic levels weekdays, 90% on weekends. So a good part of this economy is back. Next slide, please. I think what is really key to looking at retail, we have rebounded in retail so that we are back up to 82% occupancy with more than 175 retailers have had the confidence to open in Center City. Next slide, please. The most important graphic here is at the top. While there has been a move to hybrid and remote work, we are seeing a steady growth in people coming back to work in Center City. We were up at the end of August to a 75% recovery rate of all workers working in person in their offices, hotels, hospitals. At the bottom, you see a lower number. That dark purple area is our office district. We're at a 57 or 58% recovery. So those people who have jobs that lend themselves to that can be are not back as much. Next slide, please. This may be a little hard to read unless you have it up close, but everybody talks about the peak of Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. There clearly is a Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday peak, but you will see that 2023 numbers are higher than 2022, are higher than 2021. We are in a steady return to work. Whether we get back to 100%, I don't want to predict, but those numbers are still going in the right direction. Most importantly, this slide at the bottom, when we compare Philadelphia to the 25 other largest downtowns in the United States, we are number 4 or number 5. There are cities like Memphis and Nashville, highly dependent on tourism, that have rebounded faster. But we are back further than Midtown Manhattan, further than Boston, doing better than Washington. So the recovery rate here is very strong. And most importantly, next slide, we have regained all the jobs we lost in the pandemic and now have more jobs than we had in the city in 2019. Next slide, or the bottom, I'm sorry, the very bottom. We are partnered right now with SEPTA to welcome people in the morning. People are getting free coffee. Next slide. We're greeting them. We have the Philly Fanatic just to welcome people back, to say we want you back here. Next slide, please. We're doing a range of activities. But quite simply, my message is, you cut off SEPTA, I don't mean you, but if we do not get the required funding to support SEPTA, we start losing jobs again in this city, and those are all types of jobs, high-skilled jobs, mid-wage jobs, and low-wage jobs. SEPTA is cut off from funding. We have massive traffic congestion again coming back in this region. Rural areas may be able to work only on the automobile. Metropolitan areas cannot. I think, next slide, very quickly, major employers have major confidence in the downtown. This week, Comcast has come back to 4 days a week. Major law firms are signing leases for new office buildings. Next slide. When they move out of empty office buildings, those are getting converted to residential. We have more people living in Center City today than we did in 2019. The recovery is real, and most importantly, go to the next slide, a burgeoning life science industry coming mostly out of Drexel and Penn and University City. Next slide, please. We've got life sciences investment across Center City. It is really generating a whole set of new jobs. I don't want to in any way minimize the challenges we have faced. As an organization, we have doubled our public safety deployment. We have 50 private sector folks working in partnership as public safety with the police. Crime in Center City is 6% below what it was in 2019. Image is a different problem. We're still working on that issue. But I assure you, we're in a strong position of recovery, and we see SEPTA as absolutely essential to the vitality of jobs for the city, for the region, for arts and culture, for entry-level jobs, and for the innovation which will drive the economy in the future. Thanks for this opportunity.
Good afternoon and welcome to Philadelphia and the greater Philadelphia, southeastern Pennsylvania region. My name is Ariella Marin and I serve as the executive director of the Delaware Valley Regional Planning Commission. I've been in this role for a few months now. DVRPC is the federally designated Metropolitan Planning Organization, or MPO, for a 9-county bi-state region, which includes 4 counties in New Jersey and the counties of Bucks, Chester, Delaware, Montgomery, and the city of Philadelphia in Pennsylvania. We are governed, as defined in our original legislation, by an 18-member board comprised of representatives from each of our city and county governments, as well as the state departments of transportation and governor appointees from both states. The region's transit agencies, including SEPTA, participate as critical partners with DVRPC. Our federally mandated responsibility as the region's MPO is to prioritize transportation projects and investments that are funded with federal transportation dollars, which we do through the development of a long-range plan, our current one's called Connections 2050, and the preparation of a short-term capital program known as the TIP, or the Transportation Improvement Program. And we do this in partnership with our planning partners across the region. On July 28, 2022, the DVRPC board adopted the latest Transportation Improvement Program for Southeast Pennsylvania, which identifies projects and funding for the next 4 years, together with a broader program of projects recommended for PennDOT's 12-year program. The 4-year TIP includes almost 400 highway and transit projects in a financially constrained program valued at over $7.5 billion. Approximately half of this funding is for SEPTA's capital program, with the remainder for a variety of interstate and local bridge and highway projects to be undertaken by PennDOT, the city, and member governments. The overwhelming majority of this funding, over 3/4, goes towards rebuilding and maintaining our existing transportation infrastructure. We are an old region. We have very old infrastructure that needs to be taken care of. This current TIP represents the largest investment in transportation infrastructure in the region in decades, but it almost didn't happen. When DVRPC and our partners began development of the TIP in the fall of 2021, we were faced with a funding shortfall due to reduced gas tax revenue as a result of decreased driving and more fuel-efficient cars, as well as increased costs due to the rising costs of materials and construction. As a result, we began the process to remove over $750 million worth of projects from the 12-year plan. Fortunately, in November of 2021, the bipartisan infrastructure law, officially called the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, or IIJA, passed. And we were not only able to fill that $750 million hole, but to add almost $750 million to the 4-year highway TIP and over $1 billion to the 4-year transit TIP. This is great news, allowing the region to make progress addressing our backlog of deferred and delayed projects. It also allowed us to improve maintenance and to invest in new facilities to support economic growth, jobs, and opportunities in our region, such as you just heard about from Leslie Richards at SEPTA. But I'm also here today to tell you that while this new investment of federal funds is absolutely necessary and one we should celebrate, it is not sufficient to meet the needs, both here in our region and across Pennsylvania. As part of our regional long-range plan, completed and adopted by DVRPC's board in 2021, we conducted an in-depth quantitative needs assessment to determine what is required to achieve and maintain a state of good repair for existing infrastructure, improve bicycle, pedestrian, and transit services and equipment, make the physical and technological improvements needed to enhance safety and operations, and to invest in a limited number of new facilities to fill existing gaps, address congestion, and accommodate future growth. That analysis identified a need over the next 30 years for an investment of over $110 billion in our region's transportation system. But we identified available federal, state, and local funding of just under $50 billion. This more than 2-to-1 shortfall in funding is now helped by the IIJA, as we anticipate up to $5 billion in addition formula funds over the 5-year life of the bill. But that level of increased federal funding has been eaten away by inflation and also cannot be sure to continue beyond the 5-year bill. Closing the gap is also made more difficult by the continued reliance on the gasoline tax, which has put our state in a situation where state revenues are unable to keep pace over time as the nation transitions to more fuel-efficient and electric cars. If we are not able to continue to increase investment in our transportation systems, we will once again be forced to delay, defer, or drop critical projects across the region. Structurally deficient bridges will need to be wait-posted or even closed. Deteriorated roadways will not get paved. And SEPTA will not be able to serve the region's population, especially the lower-income, transit-dependent population, with reliable and regular service. These unfunded needs do not just go away, but rather become a debt on future generations and a drag on the economy, impacting the competitiveness of our region and the resilience of our communities. For example, in addition to the SEPTA projects you heard about today, there are significant road projects in each of our five Pennsylvania counties that have not yet been able to advance and likely will not be able to fully advance without additional funding. These include the Street Road Bridge over I-95 in Bucks County, improvements along Section 200 of US 202 in Chester County, safety and design improvements along Route 291 in Delaware County, traffic management along US 422 in Montgomery County, and fully funding reconstruction and safety improvements on Roosevelt Boulevard and other streets in the city of Philadelphia. I do want to reiterate what you've heard today. Transit is at a particularly vulnerable junction because of the COVID pandemic. Maintaining transit service is critically important to the economy and communities of the region and the state. Without a viable transit system, people will waste more time sitting in congestion. Freight deliveries will be delayed and cost more. Workers relying on transit will take longer to get to work, if they can get there at all. Our most vulnerable populations will have more difficulty getting to medical appointments and work and school, and our social services will be more overburdened. This is a time when we need to be able to increase service and demonstrate how transit can be the most convenient and accessible way to travel around our region. If service is cut due to budget challenges, even fewer individuals will be able to rely on transit to get to work, home, and other destinations, causing revenues to further decline. You've heard a lot of numbers today, and you're hearing a lot of testimonies, but you have to think of the people who are at the center of this when we talk about this decline. My middle schooler is dependent on taking SEPTA to school, and I walk her to transit in the morning. SEPTA ambassadors are there, which is really helpful as a parent because my child is very small. But she's able to take school, and she gets to school on transit and takes it with other kids. Because service has been cut a little since COVID, the train isn't as convenient as it used to be, so she has to get up much earlier. And she waits for a train a long time and comes home much later. But we make it work. If transit was cut, if service was cut, transit would not be an option for her to get to school. We would have to drive in the car because we have the means to do it, or we'd have to use funding, which fortunately we're in a position to do, our own personal money to figure out other ways for her to get to school, or I can be a little late for work. I have that flexibility. Most in our region do not have that flexibility and do not have those means to find alternative ways of getting to school. We're already seeing other parents, because of how service isn't where it used to be, make the decision to take private vehicles or a private bus, which adds to congestion. Traffic congestion in our region is up to pre-COVID levels. It's the transit levels that are still below. So if anything, we need to be making transit even more convenient and more accessible to address our challenges as a region. So I believe we now need an all-hands-on-deck solution where the Commonwealth and our local governments all contribute and work in partnership with the federal government to secure predictable and adequate long-term funding to meet our transportation needs. This means support from our congressional members to continue or expand our current level when IIJ expires in 3 years. It also means securing enough state funding to fully take advantage of the IIJA resources and to set Pennsylvania on a stable path for the future. For example, PennDOT has estimated that the agency will need as much as $1 billion in additional match funds over the 5 years of IIJA bill just to be able to access the expected increases in formula funds. And PennDOT, SEPTA, and our municipal and county governments will need additional funds to serve as matches for the many competitive grant opportunities in the IIJA. There are over $100 billion worth of competitive grants identified in the IIJA, almost all of which require additional non-federal match funding, and we need to be prepared to apply, compete, and get our share to benefit this region and this state. If we don't, we're letting others get the funding from IIJA while we sit back and watch. While it may never seem a popular idea to raise taxes or impose additional fees, particularly in the current economic climate, transportation services must be viewed as a public good, a utility that everyone uses, such as water and sanitation services. Quality transportation is not a luxury, it's a necessity. Our transportation investment needs are great, and while our options are constrained, we do have options. Over the past several years, DVRPC and the five counties of southeastern Pennsylvania have been working together to identify potential mechanisms that could be used to raise funds locally in the region to supplement available state and federal funding. We look forward to working with you to help advance that initiative in order to add more tools to the toolbox to raise funds at the state and local level to invest in our transportation system. These are the two House bills that were discussed earlier in today's hearing. These local funding options are crucial for SEPTA, as every $1 in local match allows SEPTA to leverage $7 in state funding for operating and more than $31 for capital improvements. As you heard earlier, investments in transit in particular provide multiple benefits for neighborhoods, communities, and the region as a whole. So in closing, there is no question that the price of failure is considerable and the cost of doing nothing is too high. Transportation investment is a public responsibility, providing a public good. It is also a positive investment in our future with a proven return on that investment, especially investments in transit, as transit improves health benefits by promoting physical activity, provides economic benefits to all communities it serves, improves fuel efficiency, reduces air pollution, improves road congestion, improves community mobility and access to jobs, and provides an equitable transportation system. One way to expand the workforce and improve a region's economy is by giving more people the ability to get to their jobs, their schools, and their doctors. Public transit reduces the barrier of needing to be able to afford a car and gasoline or rely on someone who owns a vehicle to earn a paycheck. Those states and regions making that investment in transit systems, and many of them are, will have a competitive economic advantage. It's not just an economic advantage over Philadelphia or this region, but this actually impacts the entire state. Countless studies have documented that every public dollar spent on transportation infrastructure yields a positive return in terms of job growth and tax revenue, and there are a lot of options on how to pay for that investment. I urge each of you to work with your colleagues to advance a strategy to provide sufficient and sustainable transportation investment for our future. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ms. Marin. Next up, we have Connor DeShoemaker. Thank you, sir.
Great. Hello to Acting Chair Mullins, Minority Chair Benninghoff, House Transportation Committee, gathered transit agencies, and the public. My name is Connor DeShoemaker. I'm the Coalition Manager for Transit Forward Philadelphia. We're a coalition of over 30 neighborhood associations, CDCs, environmental justice organizations, immigrant and refugee support groups, elder and disabled rights groups, and others advocating for affordable, accessible, and reliable public transportation in southeast Pennsylvania. We are also one of the convening organizations for the statewide Transit for All PA Coalition, acting under a shared mission of reliable, equitable funding for public transportation that serves millions across all 67 counties in the Commonwealth. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today and discuss opportunities to stabilize and improve funding for transit in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. While our voices and perspectives are diverse in background, rural, urban, and suburban, we're united in recognizing the power of transit in providing access to economic opportunity, community connection, and efficiency and sustainability to all. Today, we're asking the House Transportation Committee to support an increase in the state's sales tax allocation for the Public Transportation Trust Fund by just 2% for transit agencies' operating expenses, and to support the passage of local enabling legislation for local governments to raise matching dollars and access the unprecedented new capital available through the federal government's IIJA and IRA. As this body knows well, Pennsylvania's main funding bill, Act 89 for transit, ended in 2022. At the same time, the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic have permanently altered our transportation patterns in cities of all sizes. While the federal government has provided crucial emergency relief funds for the last few years, this money is already running out, with SEPTA in particular specifically facing a projected $240 million operating deficit beginning in FY 2025. To even maintain current service levels, this would require major service cuts and fare increases that Ms. Richards elaborated on earlier, just as inflation is racking those most dependent on transit and our housing crisis continues to mount. Despite these challenges, state government has growth in sales tax revenues and can use that money to serve its goals in access to the workforce, congestion mitigation and air quality, and enhancing vital connections for older adults and residents with disabilities. We urge the House Transportation Committee and House leadership to support raising the Public Transportation Trust Fund's sales tax allocation just 2%, from 4.6% or 4.4% to 6.4%, and provide $295 million more dollars for our transit agencies at this time of urgent need. And best of all, this comes without raising taxes on anyone. For SEPTA alone, this erases $190 million of its projected FY 2025 deficit. By providing these crucial operating dollars, our transit agencies can focus their energies on adapting to our new travel patterns, with returning and even growing ridership during weekday afternoons, evenings, and weekends. Transit isn't just for 9-to-5 commuting, as we've designed it for the last century. It's for accessing major events like the recent Taylor Swift and Beyonce concerts or Eagles football games, traveling to essential medical appointments, which is the most common thing I hear from our disabled and elderly residents, visiting family across the metro area, talking about students accessing their families in the suburbs or in more rural parts of the state, and increasing accessibility for elders and disabled community members. In survey after survey, transit riders agree. Frequent and reliable service is the most important factor in use of transit service. Similarly, with the arrival of the federal IIJA and IRA, our Commonwealth is primed for unprecedented capital investment in our transit systems. But as it currently stands, Pennsylvania cities and counties can't even qualify for a variety of federal funding streams due to a lack of local matching dollars and a state preemption from raising them through dedicated money. Ohio, Arizona, Washington, and Colorado. States disparate in geography, politics, and population, but all currently more competitive than Pennsylvania because they allow local governments to raise local, dedicated capital money for transportation projects. Legislation like HB 1307 and HB 902 provides a path. We simply need the House Transportation Committee to commit to taking it. Every day our Commonwealth delays, we miss out on the 5-to-1, we've heard 7-to-1, return on investment transit projects provide. We miss out on infrastructure dollars going to other states from these federal pots. With local enabling legislation, we can turn our attention to ambitious and popular projects like the East Busway expansion in Allegheny County, the return of Reading Intercity train service, and the century-in-waiting Roosevelt Boulevard subway that's gathering a lot of attention in southeastern Pennsylvania. We can finally make good on the promise of the Americans with Disabilities Act by making all public transportation fully accessible. This is another area where we're greatly lacking in our region. Thank you to the House Transportation Committee for this timely hearing. We're eager to see this body act with purpose and urgency to solve the operations funding crisis before it's too late and agencies are forced to reduce service and raise fares. By increasing the state sales tax allocation to the Public Transportation Trust Fund, we can avoid raising taxes but ensure stability and enhance dependability for transit riders, commuters, elders, our disabled family, and ensuring the success of our biggest attractions. By passing local enabling legislation, we can access the federal dollars that will first fix and make accessible our Commonwealth's transportation infrastructure on the way to becoming world class. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. We have a tremendous opportunity to capitalize on federal dollars and keep stable our very fragile economic recovery, as noted by Mr. Levy, in the wake of the pandemic. We look forward to the actions of Acting Chair Representative Mullins, Chair Representative Nielsen, and Minority Chair Representative Carrie Benninghoff, and the remainder of the House Transportation Committee. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Dishmaker. Any questions for the panel from the membership? Representative Sharon.
Thank you very much. I apologize, I'm in the process of getting my voice back from paralyzed vocal cords. So forgive me if it goes up and down. You are right, Ms. Marin, you mentioned we heard a lot of statistics, a lot of numbers today, digesting many of them. But in particular, I wanted to go to Mr. Levy with a couple follow-up questions, if you don't mind. Listening to all the testifiers today, being straightforward, your slides and your presentation is probably the most positive. You made a statement towards the end where you said we're rebounding, numbers are coming back pre-COVID, but some of them really caught me off guard. Okay. Earlier, Chairman Benninghoff brought in the differences of opinion with regards to the people who would like to see the district attorney prosecute more crimes. In addition, you guys just had your police commissioner resign. Mm-hmm. I get it. It was a very turbulent time for her tenure here in Philadelphia, but there's also speculation, you know, are there more police needed in Philadelphia? With her stepping down and taking another post, you summarized it by saying we have statistics, but we have an image problem. Mm-hmm. So I am struggling, I guess, to see all the positive data that you put in your slides, especially when you closed out by saying crime is down by more than 6% in 2019 pre-COVID numbers. That's difficult for me to believe that we're back down when I see that we need more police in Philadelphia. The commissioner resigned. And they're up in Montgomery County. There's a lot of, you know, constituents from my area that are still hesitant to come down to Philadelphia. So I was hoping you could expand on your statistics versus image comment at the end.
Sure. You know, and let me just say that it's not atypical for a police commissioner at the end of an administration to seek other positions. So I don't take that as any comment. I think Danielle saw a new opportunity in another city, and she knew a new mayor would make a new decision. So I wouldn't put any judgment there. What I was referring to is numbers for Center City. Let me just say yes, across this city and in many cities, policing levels are down for multiple reasons, and we really need to rebuild and replenish police departments and change the culture of some of those departments. We are able within Center City, using the resources of the Improvement District, to add a significant amount of private sector funded, unarmed foot patrol, bicycle patrol, so we've had a success in Center City, driving down numbers. We have significant problems across the rest of the city. We have significant problems, you know, with addiction and mental illness problems in Kensington. So there are image issues of the city that are based on problems that are citywide. I don't want to minimize that we have challenges in Center City, but we have come back a very long way from where we were in 2020. And my basic point is SEPTA is essential to that recovery. We cannot fully recover without it. I share your perspective that we need a district attorney more focused on prosecution. Our biggest crime area is retail theft. We think about 20 or so individuals account for 70% of the retail theft. They're repeat offenders, so that is a priority, but this is a transportation hearing. It's an issue we need to solve as a city, but what we can do from the private sector is supplement. We closely partner with the police, and we're making substantial progress.
Okay, thank you very much.
Great.
Chair, thanks to Representative. Recognizes Representative Hohensee.
Thank you, Chair. As the prime sponsor on HB 1307, which isn't in front of this committee, I absolutely also support the idea of providing the local funding options. Before I get into that, though, I do want to say I'm a resident of Philly, grew up here, lived here almost all my life. And for what we are talking about today, which is what does mass transit do for a community, investment in mass transit will always make us safer, because when you have larger numbers of people gathering in places, whether it's outdoors at restaurants, at festivals, or in and around buses and trains, then crime goes down. That's just a fact, and there are studies that bear that out. So that if we are talking here about investing in SEPTA and in PRT and in transit all across the state, what we're also saying is we want the people in those places all to be safer as well. So my question for all of you is, as we compare the different bills that we're looking at, the local funding bills that I have and that Representative Waxman has, the SB 597 bill coming, these proposals around the sales tax, how do they fit together? What are the distinctions between them? And is it something where we ought to be doing all of them? And if we do, how do we do all of them? What do these bills mean in that sort of broader policy structure, as opposed to being just one-off solutions?
Thank you, Representative Hohenstein. And also thank you so much for your work on House Bill 1307. You know, We need to recognize that, as was noted at the very beginning of our hearing today, Act 89 was a temporary solution. That was something that was for 10 years. These are, you know, frankly, existential crises, you know, that we're facing when we talk about transportation infrastructure, and being also one of the oldest systems in the country means we need to, you know, focus on how we actually, you know, rebuild so much of this from so many years. So I think that we'd be very open to the idea of, you know, attacking these things all together, but each represents a distinct path. SB 597, apologies if I might have gotten that number wrong, that, you know, allows our rural agencies to plan well for the future. It allows them to access the same kinds of streamlined, you know, funding that our urban systems get to experience. That's something that we're actually talking about on the federal level as well. Procurement is one of the biggest sucks on our rural agencies. It's something that makes it more expensive for them to purchase technology and, you know, capital resources like even just buses and shuttles than our urban systems. So the more that we can make it easier for those rural systems to purchase, it'll save money. It's something that's, you know, doesn't require any new spend, but can streamline things and make them easier. So that's really exciting from that lens. When we talk about local enabling legislation, again, that puts us just on par with what extremely ideologically diverse states are able to do across our country in being able to raise local revenue and be able to promise and show results with that money. You know, I think about some of these, you know, projects that have happened in places like Denver, Cincinnati, or Phoenix that have built large amounts of new infrastructure, those all come through local enabling legislation that allows it for them. And then when we talk about this sales tax, what's the point of having new you know, train lines and that sort of thing if we can't run service on them? So each of these things are critical issues that we're facing and all need to be addressed for sure.
I'm not going to repeat everything we just heard because that's all accurate, but also want to clarify that the local enabling legislation is not just funding for transit. It is the priorities of the counties, and many of them will prioritize supporting transit and having a local match that will allow mostly capital projects, but there are other priorities as well that the legislation would allow to move forward in the transportation system, while the sales tax change is specific to the transit systems.
Oh. Thank you very much, Representative. Representative Curry.
Thank you. Just really quickly, I'm actually encouraged to hear about Center City and the uptick, because I know as a resident and a community member right outside of West Philadelphia in Upper Darby, it's always been one of our greatest points to be able to get to the airport, sure. Center City, to get down in there, to get to restaurants and things like that, and, you know, get closer to the city. So really happy about that. And I do feel like what you made a statement about with you know, other parts of the city struggling is true, but when you think about Center City, how do you really look at, you know, folks coming down into the city late at night and getting back out? Like, have you done the research about what that looks like as well? Because, you know, if people come in for a show, like you mentioned, sure. Beyonce and Taylor Swift, and then they want to go into the city, you know, are you finding that they're taking transportation back out, or they're doing like Uber or Lyft? Sure. Just curious.
Sure. Let me answer you indirectly, since the issue of thickness of hair and hair color came up before. We started Center City District in 1991. Those who remember the city then, it was a place that people avoided. They were afraid to come to. We have been through this before. We know what down cycles look like. nationally and internationally. This is the worst down cycle anybody in our adult life has lived through. So I don't want to minimize the challenges. I just start with the confidence. We know how to find our way out of this. We can't be consumed by pessimism. Investment in SEPTA, investment in infrastructure, investment in job training is absolutely critical for all of the cities and towns in the Commonwealth. So I start there. We are clearly seeing young people much more prone to come into Center City than older people. When you're 25 or 26, you're immortal. When you're my age, you worry. So we clearly have that challenge. But we are seeing restaurant business is doing fine in the evening. Where they're struggling still is lunchtime, because a lot of the workers aren't 100% back. But we're not seeing a challenge. Restaurants are completely full this week. The anxiety level is still high. I'm not going to conceal that. We all know the image of things. We all know what we see on television. I was simply trying to focus on the facts of recovery, which are really strong, and the point of this hearing, take away SEPTA, and we lose that momentum here. Pittsburgh loses that momentum. It's absolutely critical to rebuilding from the largest sort of medical disaster we've all lived through.
Sorry, if I may speak up to that as well. When we talk about safety and reliability, when I meet with constituents that are all across our city, from Southwest Philadelphia to South Philly, where I live, to North Philly to the Northeast, the number one thing that people talk about when they talk about safety is the trainer bus gonna come? They would feel safe if it ran reliably. They would feel safe if it came on schedule. And when we have an operator deficit, when we have the fear of cuts, when we have infrastructure that breaks, when those things happen, reliability takes a hit, and it takes a long time to rebuild confidence in the system after you have some bad experiences on it. And I'll tell you that again improves, and the more people, as Representative Hohenstein mentioned, are there and able to depend on it, that perception of safety, that connection to the people around you, those social bonds can rebuild. And so, if we continue to, do a death of 1,000 cuts, those are the kinds of things that go away. When we talk about wanting to solve crime, it comes through rebuilding connections to one another and reliability on our institutions. And this body is one that people rely on every day.
Any other questions from the members? All right, well, I just want to say, of course, thank you again to SEPTA for hosting this very informative hearing. To those who traveled near and far, from my colleagues to our testifiers, and of course, our incredible staff members and communications professionals, thank you all for what it takes to make these hearings happen. And especially thanks to the testifiers for reminding us just how big of a task we have ahead of us.
Enjoy yourself tonight.
With that, I'll turn it over to Chairman Benninghoff for any closing remarks.
I think you did well, Acting Chairman, and just echo the same comments. And we do know that your time is very valuable, and we appreciate the time you put together on the packets, the information, and we will share that with the committee members that are not able to be here as we review and process through all this. So thank you very much. And thanks for being a good host here at the beautiful city.
Seeing no other business before the committee, I thank you all for putting up with me instead of the gregarious Ed Neal.